Well, on this topic, we are going to study the linear control theory. So remember that when we're talking about the control system, we want to find these forces and torques that are necessary for moving this N effector, this robotic system. And moreover, we want that this N effector follow a desired motion that we establish by this trajectory generation block that come from the position, velocity, and accelerations for any of these discrete interpolation points in order to follow a desired trajectory. And also we are talking about these closed loop systems, and then why we use a feedback signal from the output of these control systems. In a typical robot control system, we have two approaches to analyze these block diagrams. So the first one is a separate approach when we add an additional actuator block in order to be more specific about what is the relationship between these components of these control systems. A simplified approach try to reduce only one block for the actuator and mechanical robot that we add in only one single block. So in this course, we are going to focus more on this part. So we are going to avoid the actuator model, the electrical or pneumatic or hydraulic, if we have different actuators, in order to only focus as on a mechanical block together with the actuator and the mechanical part, and more focus on the controller block. So let's start with this example. Suppose that we have this rotational mechanical system that can be also a robotic system with one link, and then we have this electrical motor that is coupled with this shaft with an inertial mass, and also we try to model these frictional forces using this torsional damping with this factor, damping factor that we call beta T. And then we want that this shaft move to a specific position, velocity, and acceleration according with this control signal as an input, the torque that comes from an electrical motor. Now, suppose that we want to use a linear control system like we can see here. So we have as an input the desired position, and then from the output we have a feedback signal that is used to compare with the desired position in order to generate an error that's going to use it for this controller block, and then this controller block is going to generate an output that is going to be like an input for the system or plant, in this case, this rotational mechanical system. And then again, this is going to be a closed loop system. So let's start first with the modeling part. So we need to model a mechanical system with 1 degree of freedom. In this case, it's a revolute joint. So using this diagram, we can see that we have external forces, the torque, the external torque that comes from the motor, and we have this torque as an frictional forces that opposed to the input torque. So using the Lagrange equation to model this system, in this case we have only 1 degree of freedom, that is the angle theta, and external force, the torque from the motor and the torque from the torsional damping systems. So and we need to calculate the Lagrangian by finding the kinematic kinetic energy minus the potential energy. So the kinetic energy is equal to 1/2 the inertial moment times the angular velocity square. So that is the only kinetic energy, and the potential energy is equal to zero because we don't have any gravitational forces, and also there is no any spring on the system. So the Lagrangian is equal to the same kinetic energy, and then substituting in our dynamic equation by this Lagrangian formulation. So we need to obtain this partial derivative with respect to the joint velocity, and then this result is now for to use to obtain the temporal derivative. And for the last partial derivative, because we don't have positions in our Lagrangian equation, is equal to zero. And finally, our dynamic equation substituting a linear frictional model for the torque, we obtain these equations. In other words, this is our final linear ordinary differential equations. As we can see here, we have this inertial moment times the accelerations plus the damping factor times for the velocity equals to this external input force that need to compensate all these motions that we have here. Now, the next step is to find the Laplace transform equations. Suppose that we are going to find this Laplace equation using zero initial conditions. And then, this is our Laplace, in terms of Laplace, the equations. And then, because we want to find this transfer function of the system, remember that in transfer function for the plan, we receive as an input the torque, the external torque for the motor, and then we want to, as an input, we want to see that is the angle as an output, the system. Now, that's why our transfer function is going to relate as an output the angle and as an input the torque. So, in other words, this is our transfer function for the plan of the system in Laplace terms. Now, remember that this is our initial control system. The idea is to reduce, to find an equivalent open loop block diagram that represents the same as we can here. So we are going to call this equivalence transfer function the closed loop transfer function. In this case, we receive an input, the desired position, and as output, the desired the actual position of the mechanical system. So this, in this part, is include all this part here. No? So remember that we analyze these equivalence block diagrams in order to obtain, to reduce this closed loop system, we need to multiply the inside block diagrams and then divide by 1 plus the same that is inside of this closed loop. So this is our now equivalent transfer function. And then we suppose that the controller is a more simpler constant. Let's call Kp. And then let's substitute to our closed loop transfer function this controller and the transfer function for the plant in our general closed loop transfer function. And then finally, this is our closed loop transfer function for this control system. And then let's reduce, find another form of these equations in order to have only as a coefficient for the quadratic form as 1. And then if we compare this equation, especially for the denominator part, to the closed loop function that is used for a second order systems, we can see that these parameters that we have here are this, that in this case we have the omega n that represent the natural frequency of the system, and zeta represent the damping factor. So this one, compared with the, with our mechanical system, can be found by these equations. So we can see here that we have a parallel equivalent systems that also can be used by only the damping factor. So we are going to use that this equation, and then we want to analyze this response of the systems. Supposing that we receive as an input a unit state signal as a desired position, and then we assume that the natural frequency is 1, and we want to evaluate the system for different damping factors from 0 to 0.1, 0.3, 0.5, 0.7, 1, and 2. In order to do this, it's more easy to make to do a program. In this case, we are going to use the Octave or MATLAB programs. And then this is our program that we are going to use different values of this damping factor, zeta. This is our omega value. And then this is a unit step function. And then we are going to make a simulation for 0 to 20 seconds in order to have this transfer function and the also the plots for these different values of this damping factor. Now, let's check our results for these different values for this damping constant zeta. And then, as we can see here, from 0 for this damping factor, we can see that we have a free oscillation response. So the system physically always is going to oscillate and never going to have a stable position. So always is going to oscillate. So we in this case, we don't have a damping factor, and physically we always have a system that always is in infinite oscillations. Now, suppose that this damping factor is 1, and this is known by a critical damping response. So in this case, in this curve, we can see that the system reaches the desired value in without any oscillations and in the minimum time. Now, if this value is bigger than 1, so this is known as the overdamping response. So the system is going to take more time to reach the enter, the input, the reference input of the systems. As long as you use a bigger value for this damping factor, you can see here that the time to reach this reference is going to take more time. And finally, we have the underdamped response, that is the value between 0 and 1. We have several examples here, 0.1, 0.3, 0.5, and this is 0.7. So we have our very small value for the damping factor. So in this case, we had more oscillations, but at the end, the system is going to reach also the reference. It's going to take more time, except that we have more oscillations. This oscillation is going to reduce as long as we close to the value of 1. So this is our response for this kind of system. And several physical systems is going to have the same behavior here. So as we can hear, it's very important what is this value for the damping factor. So for suppose that focus on this polynomial from the numerator fraction, we can see here that this is a quadratic function that has these general solutions in function of this damping factor and the natural frequency. We can see here for the radical part that is this value, the damping factor, is equal to 1. We can eliminate this section of this equation for the solution, and we only have that the power are equals and both of them are negative, so that's why it's a stable system, and also is when we have the critical damping response of the system. Now, there are several control techniques that we can use it. So the most basic is the on-off control. So we only send a start and shutting down the system. And then the problem here is that we can reach bigger or smaller values from a desired reference. So this is the control that is not used in a robotic system. The next one is a proportional control. We are going to use the letter P that refers to a signal that is a constant in order to have a proportional value of the error. And then with this control, we want to reach the desired motion. This next is called the derivative control, except that this one, derivative, never is used alone. So you need to use it with an additional control. It could be a proportional or it could be an integral, but you need to use an additional. It never comes alone. So in this case, it refers to the change of the error. And finally, we have the integral error with the letter I. In this case, it refers to the integral of the error with respect to time. So this one is going to accumulate all the errors that happen when in a period of time. And also we have all these combinations for these controllers. So we have the PD, proportional derivative, PI, proportional integral control, and the most famous control, PID, proportional, integral, and derivative control. So they use the three advantages for any of these control controllers. So let's start with the proportional control. So in this case, the controller, based on this proportional, is used a constant that we name KP. And then, as you remember, this in open loop, we don't have a feedback. And in closed loop, we also have a feedback that comes from the error. And this controller is going to have to multiply this error in order to make an input to the plan and then to make a control part. So let's check both of them in open loop and a closed loop, only in this proportional control technique. So suppose that we have this controller, so it's a constant value, and we are going to use the general second order plan. And then this open loop transfer function is going to relate the reference with the output of the systems, and in this case it's only a multiplication of these blocks, the controller times the the plan, and then substituting the transfer function for the plan, we have this transfer function for the open loop control system. Now we are going to test this open loop control for several values. The idea is to check several values for this constant parameter for the proportional controller from 0 to 10. And we can see here that never we are able to achieve the reference signal. So all these values in open loop control makes that the controller doesn't work. Now, analyzing the closed loop system, let's find again the transfer function for a closed loop. So we are going to relate the reference with the output, but including now this error. So including this error, we have this closed loop transfer function. And supposing that the sensor block is 1, we have substituting also the controller that is a proportional controller with a constant KP. And now substituting the transfer function for the plan, we obtain this equivalent closed loop transfer function of the system. Now, again, we are going to test this closed loop control system, assuming these parameters and also changing the value for this controller, proportional controller, from 0 to 10. And as we can see here in this plot, we can see that although we have different response for the system, all of these reach the reference input. So this is a good control in order to achieve this reference. Now, for the proportional derivative control, PD control, in this case, in a mathematical form, we need two constants, the proportional constant multiplied by the error, and a derivative constant that we are going to call the KD multiplied by the derivative of the error. So, transforming this in Laplace domain, this is our new equations. And then, finally, the transfer function for the controller in terms of the inputs, the outputs of the systems. In this case, we have the US divided by the error as an input for the controller is these equations. Now, as we can see here, the input is the error, the output is the signal U. And then this is our block diagram for this kind of system, where the controller in block diagram for a proportional derivative controller has this form. So we receive the error suffer a derivative in Laplace form, and then multiplies by the derivative constant, and it's going to add to the multiplication of this error by the proportional constant in order to generate an output that is going to use it as an input to the plan. And again, the output is going to use it as a feedback signal to compare to the reference. Now, for the proportional integral derivative control, PID, we need an additional parameter. In this case, we are going to use the KI parameter in terms of the integral of the error of the signal error of the system. Using again the Laplace transform, this is our equations. And for the transfer function for this controller, remember that the output is the US and the input is the error. This is our equation for the transfer function for the controller. In this case, in block diagram, this controller is represented in this block diagram. So again, you receive the error as an input. This error is going to multiply directly by the proportional factor, and then it's going to suffer a derivative and multiply by the derivative constant. And addition, we need to integrate in the platform times the constant, integral constant. All of these are going to add, and then the response is going to use it as an input to the plan. So let's start with this example. Suppose that we receive the transfer function as a system, as a plan, or process, and we want to obtain the response. So suppose that in this case we don't have to use a controller, so it's only to see what is the response of this system without any control from an unit step function, and we want to evaluate what is the response of the system for this plan. So the idea at the end is to have the solution in time domain in order to see what is the response of this system. So we need to multiply the input by the transfer function of the plan in order to obtain this response of the system according with this block diagram. So we need to multiply the input times the transfer function in order to obtain the response. And then substituting the transfer function of the plan and the transfer function for the input, that is a unit step function in Laplace terms, we obtain this equation. And then the next step that we have now in Laplace is to use the inverse Laplace transform to return to the time domain. So before to do that, we are going to separate this equation in partial fractions to reduce the problem of to obtain the inverse Laplace transform. So this is our partial fractions, and then applying this inverse Laplace transform for any of these terms, we can obtain the response in time domain. And applying this inverse Laplace transform for any of these terms, we obtain the solution of these linear ordinary differential equations. So this is the response, the solution of these ordinary differential equations. And then if we analyze this solution, if t is time start with zero and substitute in our solution, we can say here that also the system, the response, is going to start in zero. So when time is zero, the system starts in zero. And when time goes to infinite, the response of the system, the solution, reaches a parameter. In this case, is 1/2. So this is our solution, the response, that we expect that the system start in zero and then reaches a maximum value of 1/2. And remains in this parameter as time goes to infinite. So using a MATLAB or Octave program to simulate this transfer function, which we can see here that what we expect in our theoretical solution. So this is our plot for the response of the system. So this, the system starts in zero, and then when times goes to infinite, this reaches this 1/2 parameter and then remains in that part. Using also a block diagram in MATLAB Simulink, it's possible to have the same response of the system. In block diagram, it's easy to use these blocks that in this case we add the step. Unit step function that affects as an input to the transfer function of the plan, and we have the response And also we take a signal for the reference in order to also include in the plot, that is one, and this is our solution of the system. Now let's finish with this example. So now suppose that we need to design a PD proportional derivative controller for the previous system. So we have this transfer function for this plan or process, and now we want to apply a controller. So this controller is demanded by our proportional derivative specifically, and we want also that this proportional derivative moves the closed loop poles that are located in this value, minus 5. So is we are expecting to have a critical damping system with equals roots for the poles of the system. So let's start now for the stability analysis of this system. So this system we also analyzed in the previous problem, but we are going to repeat here again. So analyzing only the transfer function of the plan, we can see here that analyzing only the polynomial from the numerator fraction, this is our polynomial, and obtaining the roots, we have that the roots, both of them are negatives, and then, because the poles are negatives, the system is stable. So that is the first check that we need to do. And then, adding the controller system, so the plan is this block, then we add a controller system block with the controller part here and the feedback signal, in order to generate an error signal, and then have a reference and an output of this system. So now the specific controller is a proportional derivative controller that need to follow this equation or this block diagram form. So we need to obtain two constants, the constant, the derivative constant, and the proportional constant. Remember that in a proportional derivative controller, we use the error as an input of the signal that multiplies by the proportional factor that is going to add to the derivative of this error times the derivative factor in order to generate this signal that is going to affect the plan in order to achieve this final an output that we want to reach the reference. Now, the next step is that we need to find the equivalent closed-loop transfer function. Remember that in this case, we reduce our functions, the initial control system block diagram to a only open loop input and output system that relates the controller, the plan. So this is our reducing transfer function that includes the controller transfer function and the plan controller transfer function. So substituting this controller transfer function for the proportional derivative equations and also the plan, the transfer function of the plan, then we obtain finally our transfer function for the closed loop transfer function of the system. So in this case, it's a reduction between the reference and the output. But remember that this comes from a feedback system, closed loop feedback system. So here we can say here the constant that we need to obtain, the Kp for the proportional part and Kd for the derivative part. Now, remember that the problem demands that we want that the controller move the system to a desired poles. So the desired poles are the minus 5 value. So transforming these poles in a transfer function, a desired transfer function, this is our mathematical form, with equal roots in minus 5. And then focus on the denominator polynomial. This is our equation that is going to be represent the desired polynomial equation. And then we have two equations. Focus on the denominator polynomials, one that comes from the control system and one from the desired transfer function with the desired poles. So these two equations we can set in equals in order to find these constants. So the idea is to obtain the constant Kp and Kd equals the coefficients with the desired polynomial. So in this case, this part needs to equals to the this part, and this part needs to equals to the constant part. So we generate two equations that at the end result with the values for this constant for the proportional and the derivative of the controller part. So using that in a octave program, using these constants and using as a unit step function as an input of this control system for a proportional derivative controller, we can see now this response the system. Also, in a MATLAB Simulink version for the simulation, we can see here the same response. So as we can see here, we have a better response of the system using this proportional derivative controller. Now, with this idea, we can see here that it's possible to using a feedback system to control, even though we have a proportional derivative, proportional controller, or PID controller, to achieve the desired reference. And then that's why the control linear systems are very common to start an analysis for a physical system.